This is lecture 17. Today we'll start a new topic that is called the root locus technique. So this is a graphical tool for control system analysis and design. It's a graphical tool for control system analysis and design. So this is actually a graphical presentation of the closed loop calls when a system parameter is varied. So let us see a closed loop system. So this is that reference command, and we have a forward path transfer function, that is that GS, and we have one parameter involved in that forward path transfer function. So this is that closed loop. Suppose that feedback transfer function is HS. We have considered that negative feedback, and this is that output, major output. So in this case, if we just derive that closed loop transfer function, closed loop transfer function, so this one would be KGS divided by 1 plus KGS HS. And the characteristics equation is 1 plus KGS HS. So in root locus, what we do whenever this K is varied, then what would be the closed loop poles? That means roots of these characteristic equations. Those are presented graphically, and that is called that root locus. So in root locus, what we do, this is a graphical representation. This is a graphical representation of the closed loop poles. That is what we have seen here. So if this is that feedback structure with negative feedback, and K is that parameter, what is varying? So if we find that characteristic equation, we'll get that 1 plus K into GS HS. And when K is varied, then what would be the closed loop poles of this closed loop poles? Its graphical representation is known as root locus. So a graphical representation of the closed loop poles as a system parameter. So that system parameter, in this case, it is that forward path gain, but we can also represent that problem where a pole is varying or a zero is varying. That we'll be discussing later. That means this is a graphical representation of the closed loop poles as a system parameter. So it comprises of that gain, that forward path gain, or a pole, or a zero. So that means if a parameter is varied, then what would be the closed loop poles? Its graphical representation is called that root locus. So from this particular representation, that means from the closed loop transfer function, we can say that when k varies, the location of the roots of 1 plus k gs hs. So that is actually the characteristic equation. So when k varies, the locations of roots of 1 plus k gs hs equal to 0 is So that means whenever k is varied, then the roots of this characteristic equation, which are actually the closed loop poles, also will vary. So now if we plot those closed loop poles as k is varying, that is actually the root locus. The plot of varying roots, is root locus. So what we have discussed, that means this root locus technique is a graphical representation of the closed loop poles. That means if we consider a closed loop control system where this particular parameter is varying, this k is varying, then what would be the location of the closed loop poles? Its graphical representation is root locus. So when k, so now that k is varying means k may be positive, k may be negative. So if we consider that k is positive, here, so then it is that negative feedback structure. Whenever k is negative, that means if it is varying from minus infinity to zero, so if we put negative sign here, so we can say that it would be positive feedback just to keep the same structure, that means this characteristic equation. But in case of positive feedback, the characteristic equation becomes 1 minus k gs hs, and in that case, if k, say, varies from 0 to minus infinity, so effectively it becomes as 1 plus k gs hs. So let us see, that means the variation of k, so it may be positive or negative. When k is positive, k greater than 0, it is with negative feedback that we have shown here. It is with negative feedback structure. And when k is negative, indicates positive feedback structure. So here, if k is positive, that means if we take k is positive, so then we can see that it is a negative feedback structure, because in that case, the characteristic equation would be 1 plus k gs hs. And when k is negative, so we can just put here negative, and if we just put positive here, so then effectively again it would be 1 plus k gs hs. So our aim is to formulate this a closed loop control system problem in this particular framework, that is called that root locus framework. So in positive feedback, the characteristic equation is 1 minus k gs hs equal to 0. So now let us see how we can formulate some other problems, like whenever the parameter is gain, we have discussed, but whenever a parameter a pole, or when a parameter is a zero, then how can we formulate that problem in this particular framework? So in this particular framework means we need to represent the characteristic equation in this particular structure, that is 1 plus that varying parameter into GSHS. So let us see how to formulate that problem. So whenever we have a closed loop control problem like this, that is some reference command we have, and suppose the Fodor path transfer function is S plus P. So P is the pole of the Fodor path transfer function, and here this pole is varying. So then what would be the locations of closed loop poles? That is the objective of this particular problem. So we can formulate this problem in root locus framework. How? So let us find what is the closed loop transfer function. So closed loop transfer function is here, that is 1 plus, that is GS, then 1 plus GS. So that is S square plus 2S plus P into S plus 2P plus 1. So this is that characteristic equation. We can represent it as 1 plus S square plus, if we take P common here, then we have S plus 2 plus 1. So now we can divide numerator and denominator by 1 by S square plus 2S plus 1. So if we divide it, then we have 1 plus P into S plus 2 divided by S square plus 2S plus 1. So now the characteristic equation becomes in this particular problem, that is 1 plus P into S plus 2 divided by S square plus 2S plus 1 equal to 0. So now if we look at this characteristic equation and the characteristic equation that we consider in root locus, so they are in the same structure. So here we can see whenever the Fodor path parameter is k, it appears here, and in this case the varying parameter is that pole, and if we represent it in this way, then you can see the varying parameter is here, and then we have a transfer function, and this transfer function would be treated as the GSHS, and then we can apply the root locus technique. So this is the framework where the pole is varying, one pole is varying, what would be the location of the closed loop poles. So if this is our objective, how we can formulate this problem in root locus that we have discussed now. So now see the other situation, whenever we have a closed loop control system where a zero is varying. Suppose the forward path transfer function is this, and here we have a zero, which is varying, because that location of that zero is not explicitly known to us. So if this is that situation, then how we can formulate this problem in root locus framework, that is our objective. And it is clear that whenever the zero is varying, that means the closed loop poles also will be varying. So if we can represent it in graphically, so then we can understand that when zero is varying, what would be the location of the closed loop poles. So let us see how to formulate this problem. So the closed loop poles, the closed loop transfer function, that is equal to S plus Z divided by S square plus 2S plus 5 plus S plus Z. So now if we divide this numerator and denominator by S square plus here 2S and S, that is 3S divided by 5, then we have 1 plus Z plus S square plus 3S plus 5. So now we can see that this is that characteristic equation. So the characteristic equation that is 1 plus Z into 1 by S square plus 3S plus 5 equal to 0. So this is that characteristic equation. And here the problem is, this Z is varying, then we are interested in to find or to see what are the locations of the closed loop poles when Z is varying. So now interestingly we can see that this particular structure and the root locus structure what we have discussed, they are in the same framework. So we can see that whenever we have a problem like this, where Z is varying, how to formulate that problem in root locus that we have discussed. So we can see that when zero is varying, so zero is varying. So this is that situation. And here we can say that a pole is varying. And in this case, the parameter is varying. So that means there are three situations we have seen and how to formulate that problem in root locus framework that we have discussed. So now we will just see that what is root locus, just via one simple numerical example, then I hope it would be clear to all of you. So let us take one example, that is, that how, what is that root locus, what we do in the root locus, that is, if we consider a closed loop system like this, we have a gain here K1, and the plant is K2, and here the poles are S at 0 and at minus 10, that is that open loop poles. So this is that closed loop, and we have considered that negative feedback. So now the first objective is to formulate this problem in root locus framework, and here we can see that K is that gain, we can consider it is as proportional controller, and K2 is the open loop gain. So these two gains are varying. So then if we first write the closed loop transfer function, what we get? We get that K1, K2 divided by S plus 10, and then that is 1 plus K1, K2. S plus 10. So this is the closed loop transfer function, and here we can see that characteristic equation is 1 plus K1 K2 1 by S plus 10, that is equal to 0. So here we define the product of these two gains, K1 and K2, as K. So we define that this is K. So that is K equal to K1 and K2. We define it. So you can see that this particular problem is cast in standard root locus framework. So here we'll see that we have two open loop poles. So open loop poles, one is that 0, another one is minus 10. So let we label that pole 1 as minus 10 and pole 2 as origin. So let us just level it like this. So two open loop poles are there. So now, interestingly, we can see that whenever the characteristic equation is 1 plus K by S plus 10 equal to 0, when K equal to 0, then what is that situation? So we can write this particular characteristic equation in this form, that S into S plus 10 plus K equal to 0. So now when K equal to 0, you can see that when K equal to 0, so then S equal to 0 and S equal to minus 10 would satisfy this particular equation. So that means when K equal to 0, S equal to 0 and S equal to minus 10 are two roots of the characteristic equation. So from here it is clear that whenever K equal to 0, then s equal to 0 and s equal to minus 10 are the two roots of the closed loop system. And then our objective is whenever this k varies, and here the variation will be considering that k is positive, say k starts from 0 to infinity, then what would be the variation of the closed loop poles? And its graphical representation is called root locus. So let us make a table here, and from there we'll be drawing that root locus. So let us make three columns here, that is k, and this is that pole one. Here we have seen that pole one is minus 10 and pole two is 0. So here we have pole 2. So then if we vary that one, so what will you get? So sub k equal to 0. We have seen that when k equal to 0, so pole 1 is minus 10 and pole 2 is 0. So now if you calculate it, that means whenever this k equal to 5, what would be the values of s1 and s2? So if we calculate it, we get that pole 1, we get minus 9.47, and pole 2, these closed loop poles, we get minus 0.53. Similarly, if we just continue like that, that means we are increasing the value of k. So that means whenever we are varying this value of k, then what are the values of s1 and s2, so that particular characteristic equation is satisfied. We get these values. So we keep on increasing that value, and we are getting these values. So when k equal to 25, we get minus 5 and minus 5. So this is actually very interesting, because at a particular value of k, both the poles, pole 1 and pole 2, they are on the same location. So now if we keep on increasing that one, then we can see that the pole of the closed loop system, they now become complex conjugate. So that real part remains fixed and the imaginary part is varying. So this is particularly for this example. It may be different in other cases. So here, that means whenever we are varying that k, and we are increasing the value of k, and then we can see how the closed loop poles are varying. As we have seen, that means the root locus is actually the graphical representation of this particular variation. That means when k is varying, what would be the location of the poles? So you may ask, what is the importance of this particular plot? Because if you have that plot, then from there you can easily understand that whether systems would be stable or not. Because if you vary that k, for stability we know the roots of the closed loop system should be in the left half of that s-plane. And if you know that for that particular variation, if the closed loop poles are lying in the left half of that s-plane, that means that system remains stable. So let us plot it. So here you have that complex plane. You have that complex plane. So this is that real and this is that imaginary. So basically this is called that S plane. because we are just going to plot it in S plane, that is the real of S, that is sigma and j omega. So now we can see that whenever k equal to 0, so pole 1 is at minus 10 and pole 2 at 0. So we'll just use two colors. So one is at minus 10, so this is minus 10, and its value is actually k equal to 0, and when k equal to 0, there is another pole that is at 0. So now we can see that whenever k is varying, k is increasing 5, then this pole becomes minus 9.47. So minus 9.47 means it is moving along that direction, and this pole is minus 0.53. So then we can see that minus 0.53, this pole is moving like that. Then if we just look at the third one, so again it is increasing, minus 8.87, so it is here, and we can see that this pole is moving along that direction, minus 1.13, so it is here. Then again, if k equal to 15, we can see that minus 8.16, so minus 8.16, and the other case, we can see that it is minus 1.84, so like that. That means in this particular case, you can see whenever k equal to 25, both the poles are on the same location, minus 5 and minus 5. So both the poles, so it is coming, and here actually the value that is, say, so this particular value is minus 5. So this particular value is minus 5. So this is minus 5. And then what happens? Whenever you increase that value 30, then we can see that one pole, that is pole 1, is minus 5 plus j 2.25. That means pole 1 is going along this direction, and pole 2 is minus 5 minus j 2.24. That means it is going along that direction. And then the next one, you can see when k equal to 35, this pole is minus 5 and plus j 3.16. You can see that means it is increasing. This value is increasing. So 3.16, it is going like that. And the other pole is going like this. So here you can see that whenever you are increasing that value, and those values are increasing like this, and this value is also increasing like that. That means the locations of the poles are going like this. One pole is going like that, and the other pole is varying like that. So basically, this is the root locus. This particular representation is called that root locus. So what we have seen, we have taken a simple example here, and two parameters are there, that is k1 and k2, and we have represented it in this particular structure. And if we see the characteristic equation, we will get that 1 plus k into 1 by s into s plus 10, and then it would be s into s plus 10 plus k. Then we are varying this particular k, and we have seen that when k equal to 0, that root locus actually starts from the open loop poles. So open loop poles means, if you look at here, this is that open loop transfer function, and open loop poles are at 0 and minus 10. Here 0 and minus 10. And when k equal to 0, we have seen k equal to 0. So s equal to 0 and s equal to minus 10. So that means that pole root locus starts from the open loop pole, that is 0 and minus 10. And once you start varying that k in the positive range, that is, it starts from 0 and going to infinity, and we can see that the two poles are moving like that. That means these poles are the closed loop poles. And from this particular example, it is clear that this pole is going like this along that direction, and this one is going along that direction whenever k is increasing, tending to infinity. So whatever be the range of that k, all the closed loop poles, if the locus of that roots like that, so closed loop poles always in the left half of that complex plane, so that system would be stable when k is varying in the positive range, that is 0 to infinity. So this is actually the root locus. So root locus is the graphical technique, so that we have seen that root locus is the graphical representation, the graphical representation of the closed loop poles as the system parameter is varied. So here you can see that here when the system parameter k is varying, this is the graphical representation. And in this particular course, we will be learning how to plot those variations of the roots, that means whenever a transfer function is given. And here you can see that in this particular example, that open loop transfer function or that loop transfer function, that is k1 k2 by s into s plus 10. So whenever that loop transfer function is given, so then we can just plot the root locus. So that thing we will be discussing in the next class, that means how to plot that root locus. There are some rules, some techniques, that thing we will be discussing in detail. So before that, let us see what is that, what are the properties of root locus. So the properties of root locus. So we are considering that negative feedback cases, considering negative feedback case. So k we are varying from 0 to infinity. Then we have seen that the characteristic equation, that is 1 plus k gs hs equal to 0. So from here we can write that gs hs equal to minus 1, and the closed loop poles actually satisfy this characteristic equation. So then we can represent it as minus 1. So that means in polar form, that would be 1 angle 2k plus 1 into 180 degree. That is that minus 1, where k equal to 0 plus minus 1 plus minus 2 and so on. So whenever the characteristic equation is like that, then we can write k into gshs equal to minus 1, and minus 1, that is equivalently in polar form, that is 1 into this. So from here, what you will get? Two conditions. One condition is the mode of, that means if you just take the gain of kshs, that would be equal to 1. Here you can see that this one is equal to 1 whenever you take that mod of this. And the other one is that angle condition. So angle is, that means if you find this angle k of gshs, its angle, this angle would be 2k plus 1 into 180 degree. So that means whenever a characteristic equation is given, a particular value of s would satisfy this characteristic equation, means it satisfies these two conditions. One is that gain condition and another one is the phase condition. So whenever a particular value of s satisfies this gain and phase condition, then that is actually the root of this characteristic equation. So here we can write that if at s equal to s1, so that is actually the value of s, if at s equal to s1, the angle criteria, what we are trying to say in characteristic equation, if a value of s satisfies these two conditions, then this is the root of this equation. Now we are going to show that if it satisfies only angle condition, then always there would be one value of k so that this particular condition would be satisfying. So the important thing is that angle condition. So when we take a value of s equal to s1, if the angle condition is satisfied, then always there is a k so that this gain condition would be satisfied. That is actually we are going to point out. That is, angle criteria is satisfied when the angle criteria is satisfied, then s1 is a closed loop pole. So k would be equal to 1 by mod of gshs. So that is the value of k. So that is the value of k for which that gain condition would be satisfying. So k, there always exists a k such that this particular condition is satisfied. So that means if s equal to s1, if at s equal to s1 the angle criterion is satisfied, say suppose the second condition is satisfied, that angle criterion, then s1 is a closed loop pole. If we just set k equal to this one, that means for this particular value of k, s1 would be the pole of the characteristic equation because it satisfies that angle condition. So this is very important. That means in root locus, what we do, we just vary this k and try to find what is the value of s so that this particular equation is satisfied. That means that is the characteristic equation. And we have written that characteristic equation in this polar form, that is k gshs equal to minus 1. So if we write it in polar form, then we get the two conditions. One is that gain condition, another one is that phase condition. So now we are just pointing out, that means whenever we have for which this phase condition is satisfied, then automatically we would be having one k, and that k value is this one, such that this gain condition would be satisfied. So in root locus, basically that phase condition is important. So once that phase is satisfied, always we can find a gain so that the characteristic equation would be satisfied. So now we will just take one small example and we can find, that means how it works. That is, say here, so let kgshs, so that is actually that loop transfer function with that gain, that is k. So that means there should not be any confusion. Whenever kgshs is given, it implies that, so this kgs and here this is that hs, so this is that loop transfer function is given. So loop transfer function is given, that is k into s plus 3 plus s plus 4 by s plus 1 plus s plus 2. So then if we just get that all zero map, then what do you get? So let us see. So in the pole zero map, so that means this is that S plane, and so two poles are there. One is that at minus one, another one is at minus two. So minus one, and another one is at minus two, and then two zeros are there, minus three and minus four. So minus three and minus four. We have seen that in pole zero map, we represented it like this. So this is minus three and minus four. So now this is that S plane. And if we say that a particular point, say suppose this is a point. So whether this point would satisfy that characteristic equation or not, because we are interested in to find a value of S so that this characteristic equation is satisfied, then we would say that this value is the roots of that characteristic equation corresponding to a value of K. So now if we take a particular point in S plane, then when this particular point would be satisfying this condition, the phase condition, because we have seen if it satisfies this phase condition, then we will be getting a value of K so that this gain condition would be satisfied. So if we just connect those zeros here and these are the two poles, so if we connect those lines, those vectors, then we can see that the angle, so this is one angle, say suppose this is that theta 4 and this is that angle, that is theta 3, and this is one angle, that is theta 2, and this is that angle theta 1. So this line, this is that reference line, that is that 0 degree. So then we can see that the angle of this particular transfer function, so what would be the angle here? The poles are in the denominator, so whenever we bring it in the numerator, so the contribution due to this pole would be negative, because the pole in the denominator, if we bring it in the numerator, so basically the contribution of the pole is negative. So here you can see that this theta 4 and theta 3, these are the two angles contributed by these two poles. So obviously that angle that you would have, that is minus theta 3 and minus theta 4. So these are the two angles contributed by the poles. And why we are taking negative? Because those poles are in the denominator. So, and zeros are in the numerator. So then what is the angle contribution? That is theta 1 and theta 2. So that means they should be positive, theta 1 plus theta 2. So these four angles, so you can see here, so these two angles are contributed by the zero, and they are positive because they are in the numerator, and these two poles are contributing angle minus theta 1 and theta 4. So if we just add those four angles, so they satisfy this phase condition, means these four angles, it would be equal to 2k plus 1, 180 degree. So that means 2k plus 1, 180 degree. So if this particular condition is satisfied, then we would say that this point, that means this S equal to S1 point, actually would be satisfying the characteristic equation for this particular open loop transfer function. So that means the characteristic equation is 1 plus K GS HS equal to 0. So that means if this particular condition is satisfied, then this s equal to s1 would satisfy this characteristic equation, because we have already discussed. That means for satisfying this characteristic equation means we need to satisfy these two conditions. So now suppose this phase condition is satisfied. So then we can write that if this condition is satisfied, then s equal to s1 is a closed loop pole, is a closed loop pole. Then what would be the corresponding value of k? The corresponding value of k, so here we can see that k is mod of gshs. So gshs is, if we write this gshs here, so gshs is this one. So then in the numerator, if we write gshs here, in the denominator we have all zeros and all poles will come to the numerator. So if we take the mod of that, then what will we get? That is actually the product of, this is that product of all pole lengths divided by product of all zero lengths. So pole lengths and zero lengths means, so whenever you have drawn those vectors, so those are actually the length. That means if s equal to s1, this is that point. So the length from this point to this particular pole is this one. Similarly, we can have the length from this particular point to this pole is this one. So like that. And as we have seen that k is equal to 1 by the mod of gshs, so here that is all zero would be in the denominator and all poles will come to the numerator. So here you can see that k is equal to the product of all pole lengths by product of all zero lengths. So next day we will be discussing how to draw this root locus, because we have just seen one particular example, but it is difficult to calculate all the values just by varying that k. And finally, if you get those value, those data points, then you can have this plot. But that are some techniques, there are some rules for drawing this root locus. That thing we'll be discussing in the next class. So let us see what we have discussed today. So root locus is a graphical tool for control systems analysis and design. Whenever you have a closed loop system, so then suppose a parameter is varying, that parameter may be that gain or a pole or a zero, and we have seen how to formulate that problem in root locus framework. And then we have taken one example, and numerically we have shown what is root locus. That means if you vary that k, so basically this is the locus of two poles, how this pole minus 10 and how this pole 0 is varying when k is varied. So that is actually the plot of that root locus, and we have seen that when k equal to 0, that root locus starts from that open loop poles. And here we have seen the properties of that root locus. Our characteristic equation is satisfied means these two conditions are satisfied. One is that gain, another one is that phase. And the interestingly, we have seen once the phase is satisfied, always we can find a gain. And from here we have understood how to find the gain of k for which that characteristic equation would be satisfied, and it is that product of that pole length divided by that product of that zero length. Thank you.